magic dust. We all know it when we come across it. These two kids are just covered in this magic dust. It's what makes a place the kind of place that you don't want to leave. And how come all the people who put their hands up are professionals? You know, for my credit, I'm a planner and an architect, so I get a double whammy. How come we're not creating those kind of places? How come Gale Architects exists to go into cities and talk to politicians, planners, engineers, to try and get them to think about creating places where people are happy, where people want to be? And that's what I spend my time doing. I was born here, a small provincial town called Pistoia in Tuscany. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Stand it, I like wandering.
Can you take it
off?
It's a radio
mic. No, of course not. I might break into song. And the imprinting that I got from growing up there is baggage that I have. When I was a student, I was fascinated with Italian Futurism, a kind of a very powerful art movement in the 20s. Sant'Elia, who is his 100th centenary of his death next July, I think, this July, was a truly modern architect. 1929, he was designing things like this. So I kind of ponder what happened to modernism, because, you know, God rest their souls, our Hadid wasn't doing anything better than that. What's happened to this notion of modernism? That's my favorite building. It's the Douglas House by Richard Meyer. I love it. I think the aesthetics of it are really pleasing. I could never live in it. I have four kids. Everything in that house is designed to be in a specific place, and it looks enchanting. But it would just drive me nuts, because unless it's a right angle, it doesn't fit. And you know, but I'm trying to expose where I come from in terms of all the baggage that I have, which is really important. I live here, in the west end of Glasgow. And the square is actually quite important. It's a kilometre square. And it contains life. I choose to live here because my office is in Copenhagen, so my commute is a bit of a pain in the ass. But I choose to live here because there's everything that I ever will need. I don't actually use those facilities when I'm there, but I know that they're there. And there's something really important about that. I get paid to think about cities. And what's really interesting, it's become really simple to me, is that a city is a reflection of the culture, culture being a very important component of what we do, of the people that created that city. And culturally, we used to create, you know, York is a fabulous place. But I would suspect the fabulousness of York will fit in less than a kilometre square box. You know, I'm going to be totally honest about what I feel. Italo Calvino is somebody that actually shaped my thinking when I was a student. And you know, that quote's all about, you know, we need to change, but you cannot forget where you came from. And that's another really important thing. It's not about replicating the past, but it's understanding your roots, which is really important. This is the way I feel when I walk out of the medieval centre of many cities that I'm in, and I come across the out-of-town experience, the shopping centre, the retail park, or whatever. Stick an eye out in the face. And you know what? I do travel extensively. And whether it's Latin America, China, Europe, it's the same thing. You have a kernel of a city which is logical, there's a reason for it being, and then it just vanishes and it's pain. I work for a company called Gale Architects. We're a small firm. We fly around a lot, but when we're together, we try and share food, because that's a very simple way of downloading all the soft information. There's no spreadsheets inside. It's about experience. It's about perception, which is really what drives us. We talk about placemaking. What is placemaking? How can you turn a place from the place that you don't want to be in to the kind of place that you never want to leave? And it's really simple, but I just wonder why we're not doing it. I am not a Viking. I work for a bunch of Vikings. So And you know, what Andy said is totally right. It's not about the bike. The bike is a barometer. If people can cycle in their city, it means there's something going on which is really, really positive. If you feel scared to cycle in a city, then you're actually in probably lots of cities, because most cities I am in, apart from Copenhagen and you know Amsterdam, I'm not comfortable with cycling, although I will cycle there. I use this a lot, especially when I talk to politicians, because depending where you are, the solutions for the problems, the perceived problems, will be different. If I'm working in a favela in Brazil, I'm down here. It's about survival. So if I talk about putting granite sets in the pavement, it's totally ludicrous. The problem that I see planners and I see architects using solutions that belong up here, down here. And it actually is a waste of resources. It's an insult to the local culture. So understanding where you are is really important. I think, you know, York, we're up here. It's about livability. What affects your daily life is actually inconsequential to the people down here. But to you, it means a lot. And that's really important for somebody like me to understand. It takes 300 years to create a good neighborhood. You know, but we don't have 300 years to wait around. But we keep creating neighborhoods which are not vibrant, they're not livable, but we keep doing it. Somebody makes money out of them, but it's not what we should be doing. Aristotle, and I apologize for slipping in Italian, understood this. When he talked about urban issues, he talked about security and serenity. A city has to feel safe, but it has to bring serenity to the citizens. So, you know, this is a Greek philosopher quite a while back talking about these things. Vitruvius, a Roman writer about architecture, said exactly the same. In fact, it's the first kind of time I've come across the notion of human scale. He talks about the human scale, so Jan Geel didn't coin that phrase. Vitruvius, in his 10 books about architecture, talks about cities having a human scale. If they don't have a human scale, you're doing something wrong. So, interesting. Then we come along, there's a bit of a history lesson. Anybody know Camillo Sitte? Austrian architect. In the 1800s, he was puzzled by the quality of life. So he went around Italy measuring the physical distance of all of these fabulous squares. Kind of, he got one element right. The dimensions of a square are important. But she understood what was really important. Is life, the quote's inappropriate to what I'm using. Jane Jacobs started talking about life in cities. So she is actually more in tune with Aristotle and with Vitruvius. And then we come along to this guy, Mr. Gale, and obviously I work for him, so we work together. The story begins here, because like me, he was a young, and I'm not young anymore, but when I was young, I was really arrogant, modernist architect who thought I knew all the answers. His wife Ingrid, gorgeous Ingrid, is a psychologist. And she said to Jan, why do architects not like people? Is it true? And went, what do you mean? And she took him there. He said, you tell me how an architect likes people when they create that kind of environment. And that was the beginning of that journey for Jan in the 50s. He got a scholarship, he went to Italy, close to where I come from, and he started trying to understand what was going on. Not like Camillo Sitte, as an architect thinking about the measurements. He started to focus on what people were doing in spaces, Piazza del Campo in Siena. And what Jan says about this slide, I know something very simple here. The people in the shade are Italians. The people in the sun are Scandinavians. That evening, the Scandinavians are going to be burnt. They understand the place, the Italians understand the place and the culture. So they stay in the shade. So place tells you a lot of things. So you need to understand the place, you need to understand the culture, you understand the people. Everything that we do is based on more than 40 years worth of research, starting in 1972 with Life in Between Buildings. And the latest thing, which is we didn't do, the human scale, the film about our work, which was commissioned by a separate entity, we had no control over it. And it is really important that that research continues, because that's what keeps us alive in terms of our thought process. We have a very simple methodology. We start with life. We then try to understand the space that life requires to be there. And as architects, then we think about the buildings. Now, all across the world, what happens, people start with buildings because that's where the money is. That's where the investment goes, you know? You get the building done, great. If you're lucky, you will get some public realm because the developer is kind of thinking that it needs a good pavement. And if you're very, very, very lucky, you might get some life. It's back to front. Now, I'm not trying to subvert the way we, the kind of the building industry works. We're just pointing out that what we have been doing for the past 40, 50 years is actually not delivering the kind of stuff that we want. We use co-creation. Again, what you said, Andy, is totally true. Our starting point is actually engaging and listening to people and involving them in creating solutions for their place, because otherwise it's just cultural imperialism. You know, I land somewhere in Latin America, although there's an affinity in terms of my Italian background, it's inappropriate for me to bring solutions that are in my head. We have to evolve solutions with the cultural and physical situation that we find. So that proverb hits it right in the head in terms of what we do and the way we look at it. You know, I'm talking to you. Tomorrow, I'll be lucky if you remember my name. But if I get involved in doing something with you, you will actually start to learn. And if I get involved and let you do something, then that's happened. The office manager that we have tears his hair out because, you know, what I talk about is we should be extinct. If I meet somebody that's hungry, I don't give him fish because he'll keep coming back to me to get more fish. I teach him how to fish. And, you know, that's the kind of crazy, the kind of description of a disciple. Sometimes we sit around when we have dinner and we do wonder, because we are a bit more like a religion, which worries us because that's really, I can't say that, but it's really screwed up, right? But there is an issue about what we do and why we do. We are consultants, therefore we need to charge fees, which is a pain in the backside, because we would really like to do stuff because that's what we want to do. We talk about cities for all, 8 to 80. I don't know if you've heard about 8 to 80. Gil Pilanoza came up with this thing. It's absolutely brilliant. He's one of our senior consultants. He says, always says, measure the success of a place. Would you allow your 8-year-old daughter to walk through it? Or would you allow your 8-year-old grandfather to be in that place? Now, if you're worried about their safety or their ability to be in that place, you've done something wrong. Now, there's lots of places I come across that are shiny and brand new, that have got good architectural signatures, that I wouldn't let, you know, my 17-year-old walk through. So there is a serious issue in terms of the kind of places we're creating. Everything we do is based on evidence. We gather evidence. It's not about, you know, Jan will say, I don't care what you think. You need to have a logic, a very crystal clear logic, and have the evidence to support why you do any one thing. Because otherwise it's willful. We use our urban quality criteria, which are actually very similar, or they relate to Maslow's pyramid, in terms of assessing place. That coupled with the evidence that we gather where people use place, we can then start to understand if there is an issue or a problem in our place. We work all over the world, spend far too much time in the saddest places that I know, which are airports and planes, but you know, that's a necessity that we have to do. We do public space, public life studies, which are the basic tool where we go and analyse and count everything. And these are some of the cities that we have done in. London, Moscow, New York are the kind of the highlight, the kind of the headline grabbing ones, but we've done really tiny ones because it's not about size, it's about human scale, it's about people and how people feel in a place. We, you know, land, we meet the mayor, and they immediately say to us, what kind of city should we have? And we just back it back and say, wrong question, and what you said, what kind of city do you and your citizens want? You know, how many times have you been asked that question? You know, there's a planning process which has been in place since 1947 in this country to make things better. And many people here have been involved in the formulation of a local plan. Not the plan. Put your hand up. Must be the politicians. You know, the local plan is the instrument that controls the future of your city. So every single citizen in here should have a say in that local planning process. Now, just if you want Rome as your city, Casanabona is not bad, yeah? Or do you want, and this is North Delta in Tigre, on the outskirts of Buenos Aires, which is doing a project here. The two slides that I've shown you were given in a presentation to me by the head designer for the company that's doing this. And she related Piazza Navona to that square because she was measuring it. They are the same size. Okay? This is a very skilled architectural planner who is going to develop the new city centre for North Delta. And if I, and I said to her and her boss, if I close my eyes and listen to Cecilia talking, I can paint a fantastic picture of a wonderful place. But when I see the references she's using, I am horrified. Now, we're not being fired, but I'm hoping to actually get them to understand that these are galaxies away. They have nothing to do with each other. And measuring stuff is not what this is about. It's about understanding what life is enabled here and what life is actually scared away from that bloody car park. You need a vision. You know, Moses had the vision. The burning bush told him, go to Egypt. Therefore, he knew where he was going. And many cities have visions that are simple, understandable, that all the citizens or all the departments that work for the city have. No. I come across cities that have multiple visions depending on who you're talking to. The transport planners have a vision, the planners have a vision, the architects have a vision, the politicians have a vision. Now, unless you have one vision, how the hell do you know where you're going? How do you deploy those resources in an effective way? And unfortunately, then what happens if you don't have a vision? All cities want to be Las Vegas because that's where the money is. Because the economic imperative tells you that if you have shiny lights, you have lots of people spending money, then you're successful. And it's wrong. It's totally, totally wrong. Who of you, when you go on holiday, send a postcard? Good. Who takes a picture on their mobile? Same thing, okay? Usually when there's lots of architects, they'll say, well, no, we don't. We're too cool. We don't send photographs. We all take a picture. We're sharing something, right? It used to be, wish you were here. There's something really incredible about place in us as a species. We want to share good places with people. We used to write on pieces of card, now we do a post on a mobile phone, we put it on Instagram, we put it on, you know, call it whatever you want. We communicate that experience. These are four postcards of a city that I had the pleasure of working for, which is kind of quite akin in terms of some of the heritage endowment that it has. Edinburgh, fantastic. What do you see? Castle, a bank. 80 to 90% of what you see is straightforward people's housing, right? At the time, that was what people lived in. So this city is doing really quite well out of bog standard houses. These are four postcards from the new Edinburgh. Who is going to send those postcards? Nobody. So if you actually wanted to make the economy of a place, then think about the value of the place. How much value is embedded in there? Every single developer that built those made money left. What value is left for the citizens or for the place? These are four cities and four continents. Nobody can tell me the city or the continent. These are four places and two continents. Everybody has an idea where that is. And for the architects in the audience, it ain't about the architecture, okay? There's something deeper going on here, which is really critical. This is a totally illegal clip from a film by Jacques Tati, French comedian. I could use that to explain what I do, right? Apart from that, it makes me laugh. Playtime by Jacques Tati. You should go and watch it. It's the story of this lady, and I think about 12 or other ladies from America visiting Paris. She just walked into this travel agent, and she has taken... Sorry. It didn't work. Taking a picture of this building outside. She walks into a travel agent and she's confronted with the world looking exactly the same. In 1965, a French comet was pointing out to the professional classes, hey guys, you're screwing it up. Have you done anything about it?
I don't know. You can be the judge of that.
I used this. Oh, look, it's working. I don't know what I did. Anyway, you know, I can have a drink of water. By the way, I've got a head cold and being a man, that's the end of the world, right? So I'm really suffering here. Be with me. Anyway, I use this a lot with politicians, you know, because insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result. You know, it's kind of crazy. I've worked in cities where you get paid to do the same thing. The minute you want to change something, everybody goes, oh my God, that's scary, it's risky. I said, well, if you don't like what you've got, you've got to change what you're doing, you know? And just salami slicing your kind of department doesn't actually do it. You have to be radical about what you think in terms of what the objectives are. Placemaking. It's good to use placemaking, especially when you talk to politicians and other people, because it's not the design word in it. Because most people, when you talk about design, it's going to cost me money. And you know, there are some good places that have been created. Why do we not create good places anymore? And it's good to have a scapegoat. So I use this guy. Henry Ford, right? It's actually not him. It's this guy. That's the scariest quote I've ever read. Man used to be important. From now on, the system's important. This is the efficiency movement in the late 20s in America. Taylor was absolutely incredible. His legacy to us is the crap places that we have, believe it or not. Because the planning system is a result of Taylorism. And I'm quite happy to say this because I came at use to the RTPI. Land use planning actually killed cities. It has been killing cities for the past 60 years. And one of the issues is density, right? Planners are scared of density. You know, dense is bad. We need lots of fresh air. Villa Radios, we need all this kind of stuff. Kensington and Chelsea are the densest boroughs in the UK. They have the highest real estate values in Western Europe. Density is not bad if you do it right. It's just kind of bizarre that we react to certain things. There's another person. Anybody know who this is? Has to be a machine for living in. This was his plan for central Paris. Who would send a postcard from that? We're really lucky that didn't happen. But you go across the globe and you will find cities that are still doing this to their cities. And as Ingrid said, would you live there? If you wouldn't live there, why do you expect other people to live there? So, because of Taylorism, because of the efficiency movement, this is what we created as a governance model. We have a bunch of silos. The thing is, I've never met an evil roads engineer or a bad planner. Everybody in these silos is trying to do their best. The problem is that their vision and their best is different from the guy in the next silo, so it doesn't join up. You know, it's amazing the amount of times I've gone to meetings and you have the engineer's got the Bible, the architect has got the Sanskrit, you know, and the planner has got the Quran, and they sit there clutching these documents, you know, the local plan, the transport strategy, and they will actually kill each other over it, you know, because God gave them those documents. And you have to point out to them, you know, just people like you, trying to make the world a better place, that created those documents. It wasn't God-given. And if they're not working, open your eyes, walk the streets, change them. But the planning system is just totally screwed up. You know, to actually develop a local plan takes minimum 5 years, and by the time the 5 years are gone, it's too late, it's changed. You know, the situation's changed. So there is an issue about what we have created in terms of creating place. And this is what happens, you know, then if you're the business, the entrepreneur, the developer trying to get something to happen, you've got so many conflicting views that most of the time what you do is the easiest thing. You try and please everybody, which means mediocrity is what survives. It's what I call false efficiencies. The only way you know if you're successful is if it's on time and on budget. You know, when I was a council officer, I would do a project and we'd deliver them time and budget. The councillors would slap me in the back and go, great, here's some more money, go to somebody else. You're going to go and see it? No, it's okay, time and budget, it's fine, here's some more money. Go and actually smell the place, touch it. You know, you need to understand what you're doing. The financial equation doesn't deliver the Y factor. You know, design solutions are like fingerprints, and what we do is we rubber stamp them, so we just totally devalue the solution in the first place. It's a sausage machine approach. Put all the ingredients in, and you're going to get a good sausage at the end of it. Well, places are not like that. This is the kind of places we're creating. You know, I used to be quite sanguine about these and people choose to live it. People are totally entitled to choose to live wherever they want, right? Is anybody going to send a postcard from there? You know, does it stand the postcard test? I would suspect not. These are the kind of environments that we are creating. And okay, York is tiny, but look at London, look at New York, look at Paris. This is actually happening, and it's killing us in various different ways. You know, fruit's really important, therefore we give them, you know, front seat. This is what we do. And then we think we have to rely on this technology to make us feel safe. Total failure in what we do. This is the, he's responsible for these. Now, you know, as an architect, you have to train for 7 years in the UK, okay? You are really good at what you do. Planning, 4 years, which means he's the expert. He built them, they're knocked down. This is Leeds city architect in the 60s. Now, there's an issue about the way we train people. You go to university for a normal grade, and when you become an architect, I just do architecture, I just do planning. And we screw the world up. You know, Alice knows garbage when she sees her. I'm sure I could walk 5 minutes from this spot and come across some of this stuff. Who's that for? Doesn't make it beautiful. Who's going to send a postcard on that? What's it there for? Ask these questions. Now, there's another serious issue. In MedSan and Corporal San, health and well-being are really important things. I mean, we see this globally when we go and talk to mayors. There's serious concerns about the health and well-being of their citizenship because it's costing them fortunes. And, you know, I'm an Italian. David is not as handsome as he used to be. There's a serious issue about what we're doing. And we create a situation where mental health is actually becoming a serious problem across the globe because the distresses we are creating in terms of commuting times and all sorts of different things. It's an American photographer who does brilliant pictures, takes intimate situations and he takes technology out of them. How long is that couple going to survive? You know, human relationships are the most important thing that we actually have. And we're so smart, we forget that we're human. Is the mouse happy or sad? No, I'll make it easier. What's that got to do with anything? Right, there's a fantastic piece of research which looks at synaptic growth in mice brain. And if you put a mouse in a poor environment, the synaptic growth is at one level. If you put them in a rich environment, the synaptic growth is actually exponentially bigger. This has now been replicated in humans and it's exactly the same. So why do we do this when we know that this is what's good for our brains? And I see this everywhere. You know, this is great, this is a metal. This is Copenhagen's new town. You know, Copenhagen is not perfect, guys. It's got some pretty crap bits in it as well. And that's one of them. We've been asked to kind of look at it. But it ticks the boxes. It solved the housing problems for the city. It's got fantastic infrastructure. You know what? Nobody wants to be there. Therefore, it failed. That's the slice through the mouse brains. You know, it's just kind of crazy. Environments have a total impact on our ability to feel good. And what Gandhi said is totally true. Wealth is your health, not the wealth of yourself. There's a graph that shows obesity in relationship to activity, active movement. Again, you know, that tells a very, very strong story in terms of an indicator. If you have an active population, there's going to be less of a drain on your health budget. So, what's this all about? Cities are for people. It's easy to say. And you know, over the past 10 years, I've seen lots of consultants like me using this cities are for people. You know, we're planners, we understand. But do we really actually understand what that means? This is, you know, Jan's thinking from day one. 6 million years ago, we became bipedal. It's really important to understand that. We started to walk in kind of a linear fashion. We're designed to do that. We have a ground speed of around 5 kilometers an hour, which is actually really important to understand as well. When we started to walk, our brain started to develop. We were able to go and kill the hog, put it on the shoulders, walk back to the village, feed the village. The protein intake allowed the brain to expand. It's the beginning of culture. We started to sing, we started to dance, we started to write. Beginning of culture. Remember culture and place? Think about, you know, I started to walk as part of the family group, and I'm going to go hunting, and I don't know the place. I break a branch to remember where I'm going back. The wind blows away, I never go back. I'm one of the lost billions of humans that never go back to the village. So then I put 3 stones by the road, and I start to mark the territory. My neighbour comes along and says, those 3 stones don't look good, I'm going to put 4 stones and make it look better. We started to actually have an impact on the physical environment. That's the beginning of aesthetics. That's the beginning of everything that we judge place on. We have a maximum velocity of 32 kilometres an hour, which is really important to understand as well. Who remembers that sensation? Yeah? Who's been in a swing in the last month? Wow. We all talk later. Now, the reason it's so good is because it takes you out with your design parameters. Velocity is incredibly seductive. It is incredibly dangerous because we're designed to withstand impacts of 32 kilometres an hour. You know, stand on a platform with a through train that goes faster than that, your body shrivels away because everything you say, danger, danger. It's seductive, but it's dangerous. There's a thing called Vision Zero coming out of Sweden, which again is a brilliant way of reducing fatalities. It's just about drop the speed in places where people live. You can go as fast as you want in most ways, but when you get into a place where people are there, they should dominate that landscape. We walk looking down at our feet. This is an Inca road, which I've had the pleasure of walking down. Those are boulders that size. If you don't look at your feet, you're going to get bloody nosed. We are designed to kind of, self-preservation is really important. So 6 million years later, we're still soft, cuddly, slow things. And all of this indicates that there's a set of principles related to who we are that are intrinsically tied to our ability to move. You know? The design of the city shapes our behaviour. He has no seat, therefore it looks rather unpleasant, but he's sitting there. These poor ladies are bunching up so they look the size of a car so they can cross the road safely. These are the kind of things that we do when we know these kind of environments actually make us relax, make us feel better. Cultures are different throughout the world. Climates are different, but the way you use and interpret space is virtually the same. There's only one part of the world which I've been in where that's not true, which is in the Arabian Peninsula, where there are cultural things that make the use of public space, kind of, from my point of view, just my point of view, very bizarre. They're happy with it, good luck to them. The way we use space in other parts of the world is to do with people watching. We are incredibly curious beings. And one of the favourite things that we have is looking at other human beings. That's the way to walk around. For whatever reason. You go to the best places in the world, there's an opportunity to see other people milling around. That's what makes the thing go around. We have personal space. This is so true. My Swedish colleagues get a bit upset because I'll walk a bit closer to them and you know they say, that's the distance. You get any closer, there's something wrong with them. In Kuala Lumpur, the light this in your face. So there is this thing about personal space, which you actually find in the animal world as well. You know, we all like a bit of space, depending on what mood you're in, you know. If you're feeling sad and depressed, maybe you don't want people around you. That's fine. So a 5K, our senses are critically important. We take 75% of all our stimuli through our eyes. So what we see, the field of vision, is really, really important. We have a cone of vision that defines a horizon of 3 meters. Traders have always known that. When you walk around York, look at how the detail, or walk around George in Edinburgh or Bath, the detail is at 3 meters, because that's what actually makes you want to go and see the place. So it's really quite interesting or disturbing when you see what modern architecture does. We require a lot of stimuli to stay awake. And if you don't get that amount of stimuli, it doesn't matter, you fall asleep. This is Annie Jacobsen's Central Bank in Copenhagen. This is a high piece of architecture. As a student, I looked at this building. So the first opportunity I got when I got to Copenhagen, when I took that picture, actually not that picture too. And you just go, Carrara marble, it's really boring. I have been back because I take people to see it. It's just like, great, it looked good in a drawing, but it doesn't do it for me. They're pitching me, you have something to do. While this is round the corner from the office, I walk there every day when I'm in Copenhagen because this life is different. I might trip over a bike, it doesn't matter. It makes me want to be there. Historic cities, historic contexts give you that 4 second interval. It's quite interesting, you see this throughout the world, whether it's in China or North America, there is this thing that's happening. Shopping mall designers know this, and not for 1 minute am I advocating the design of a shopping mall. They have rhythms, they put smells and music to make it interesting, so you're stimulated. If you're stimulated, you will remember and you will spend money. Who remembers playing in a Wendy house? It's quite interesting that when I was a kid, my father was a bit worried because I loved playing in my sister's Wendy house. And I now know why I love playing in my sister's Wendy house. Because it made me feel good. It was the right size. It was a human scale for me when I was a small kid. When I was a student, I went to a De Fonts when the Grand Arch was finished, because that's what architecture students did, took a picture, and me and my then girlfriend went back somewhere else for a coffee. This is a grand projet designed by really famous architects. Who wants to spend time there? Rather be in a Wendy house than there. The social field of vision is actually critically important when you think about urban scale things. At 100 metres, you can tell whether it's a saber-toothed tiger or a human. And you can take, you know, it's about having options. If you create an environment where you have no options, your brain will say, don't be there. When you get closer, you start to recognize different features. You know, public distance, this is like me. I'm the preacher. I know everything, so I keep you at bay. But the really interesting thing is, as you get closer to people, the way that you react to them totally changes, because you can then determine whether they're insane, they're going to murder you or whatever. And it's really important that if you're in a car or in a motorbike going fast, you don't have that human contact, which is critically important. You can tell she's happy. You know, and it all comes from the intimate distance, but it all comes from, when you get to that, from the imprinting of the baby to the mother's eyes. That's the way we actually understand the world. It's so simple. So how do we confuse what we do? This is Malmo in Sweden, across the road from Copenhagen. It's designed around the 5 kilometer environment. When I first met Jan, he said to me, go to Malmo. I drove into Malmo, because you can, because that's a road. Can you see any skinny heritage lines? Can you see any signs that tell you you're gonna get fined? No. There are big lumps of granite. There's kids playing. You go slowly because everything there tells you this is a people place. You can actually, either one of my colleagues lives here and my kids play in the street. It's a fantastic place to go. Architecturally, it doesn't do it for me, but that's a secondary matter. It's a really pleasant place. Whenever the sun shines, everybody goes out. And you get lots of architects going taking pictures of it as well. What we keep doing is we keep crashing the 60 kilometer environment into the 5K environment. And then we wonder why we get it wrong. You recognize this place. This was taken many years ago. There are traditional cities, York, Venice, there's lots of traditional cities. If you're not careful, your city gets invaded. And I think York has been doing some fantastic things in terms of stopping the car invasion. There's lots of really positive stuff that's happening here. You know, in terms of when I got asked to come and speak in York, I thought, well, you don't really need me to come and speak because you know what you're doing. But the reality is, if you don't stop that car invasion, this is what happens to your city. And then suburbia and the malls become the only answer. Now, it's quite interesting in terms of the way cities grow and the way cities can reconquer themselves. This is The Hague in the Netherlands. The year before I took this picture, this was a car park. And you've done it here. I've seen lots of really nice examples of places that have been returned or been reconquered. The interesting thing is, there's a tram here and it still goes by. The only thing is, the tram velocities drop so that you can actually sit and have a drink without stuff getting whooshed away with the result velocity of the tram. So everybody, you know, not the politicians, everybody has difficult decisions to make. Is this the world you want? These are roads. Or is this the world you want? These are streets. Subtle difference, which actually exists in the British language, doesn't exist in Italian, doesn't exist in Danish, which is really quite good. But streets are human scale. Fifth Avenue is a fantastic street. You always must remember that it doesn't matter how you get there. The vast majority of us are lucky enough to become pedestrians. Right? Even if you cycle, if you take a plane, we then walk. So why is the pedestrian realm the one that is not thought about at all? The fattening carrot must be good. This burns money and makes you fat. Well, that, brandy. This burns calories and makes you healthy. Saves you money. This is what's been happening. Britain, statistically, is going to be the fattest country in Europe in the next couple of years. Mexico is absolutely unbelievable place in terms of obesity. It's crazy. And this is what we do, you know. You have a stressful day in the office, you drive to the gym, take the escalator up, you put a lycra on, you put headphones in so you ignore everybody around you, you run around like a mad hamster, you sweat like a pig, you go home, have a burger and a beer. That's a good way to die. That's not a way to live, you know. There's another really insidious thing, which is the pollution that we create, and it's really interesting, it's not purely cars. Any burning of carbon fossil fuels creates pollution which is noxious to us. The latest research shows that it has a direct impact on child's brain development, which is shocking, you know. In Europe, purely related to diesel, 4,500 deaths. You know, this is a real issue for the health of your population. The health of your children and your grandchildren. What makes people happy? We are healthy. We actually know this. This is kind of received wisdom now. Fresh air, not here with diesel fumes. You know, the thing is, I go to lots of places and I see people having coffees next to cars going by, and you just go, just because you can't see it, it doesn't mean it's not going to kill you. We did a project in London, Regent Street, called Summer Streets. And I love London, I love spending time there. But every time I went, because I had to spend a day in Regent Street, I felt my shirts going grey with the garbage in the air. The Royal College did a study for us that showed that you were 19% more liable of dying of bronchial diseases if you lived in that area. Now, I did a workshop with, you know, most bizarre workshop with people that, you know, were really, really wealthy, and they thought I was going to stop them parking the Bentleys in their neighbourhood. And you know, the fear or the hate was palpable when I went into the room. And you know, then I started talking, I don't really care about your cars. Your cars are the least of my worries. It's the buses and the taxis that are killing you as much as a poor person. And it was really interesting the way that nobody hadn't thought about that, because pollution just goes. It doesn't respect boundaries. It doesn't respect ownership lines. So fresh air. Walk in the park, regular exercise. We know that even jumping around like hamster for 20 minutes, 3 times a week is going to extend your life. But you don't have to don lycra. Just walk the kids to school, walk the dogs in the park. That's all you need to do. It's about being active. But if your place doesn't encourage you to be active, then you're not going to be active. And the most important one in terms of mental health and physical health is positive human contact. If you live in a 60-kilometre environment, you're not going to have positive contact. A good friend of mine was Scotland's chief medical officer, Sir Harry Burns. And he paid for a study that looked at the biochemistry of a hug. And it was absolutely incredible. If you give somebody a proper hug, not a Hollywood hug, it reduces stress levels in you immediately. And stress is one of the biggest killers. You know, and okay, you're not, the UK is not like Sweden where if you touch people, there's something wrong with you. But you know, that human contact is really, really important. Who's heard of smoker diabetes? This is a global epidemic. Nations across the world are putting billions of dollars into fighting the effects of smoking and diabetes, which they have to do. You know, I would not change that. We need to really tackle those issues. But what's really interesting is when you look at the statistics of what's killing us, is inactivity is the biggest killer, right? So if your place encourages you to drive and not to walk or cycle, you're actually costing that yourself and that nation billions of dollars. So simple. So,
oh,
is it confusing? The value of place. Richard Florida has been talking about the value of place for quite a while, and it's not, I've not changed the size, it's not his latest book, it's about 3 books ago. I have an issue with Richard Florida in terms of some of the things that he says, but he's got this right. Who can recognise that place? Anybody?
Paris.
Remember the Red Square? That's the same scale. Okay. The amount of life in there. Recognise that one? What about the life in there? I actually visited somebody here. I was having a meeting. My God, that was a bizarre experience. A shadow might give it away.
Barcelona.
Look at this. Yeah. Corbusier would have just wiped that out because that is bad. Barcelona, the old town is absolutely fantastic. This, one of my favourite places in New York. Recognise that?
York.
It's the same scale. Within a kilometre square, you have, this could be Barcelona. It's not the scale of Barcelona. You know, you've got lots of potential within that 1 kilometre square. Very close to my heart, Florence. And it's not about the physical dimensions, it's about the amount of life that is enabled to actually happen throughout the clock in that area. Venice. This is Jan's favourite place. So, you as birds recognise place. So when you walk the streets and you have smells, sounds, the cultural impact is even greater. Identity is really important. So we went from this, and because of efficiency movement, we are doing that. And you know what? Doesn't matter what your planners are saying, we're still doing that. Because if people want to put buildings too close together, there's a rule that says you can. If people want to do something which means that the refuse collector guy's got to walk more than 12 metres, he can. All of these rules are really good at one level. But I was talking to a municipality recently and I said, you have a target to reach Kyoto Agreement by, you know, 10 years from now. Your planning guidance and your transport guidance is actually going to prevent you doing that. Because you expect people to have 2.4 car parking spaces. You expect all of this stuff that means the places you're creating that conform to those rules will never be the kind of place that will meet those targets. And it's quite interesting that they have never thought about that. So it's about how comprehensively do you understand what you're trying to do? What is the vision? It's what Jan calls virtual architecture. You just draw stuff down, right? And then we walk away from it. As a consultant, you know, I don't have to live there, so I can do whatever I want. Wrong. Brasilia, Lucio Costa's Brasilia. As a student, I loved that master plan. It's this ego. It was so poetic. I have now been there. And you just go, wow, was he screwed up? This place is inhuman. There's some nice objects in it, you know. Mimmaya did some nice buildings, but it's just like bad. It's really, really bad place. It's a World Heritage site. We were asked to do some work. You can't touch anything. It's like, okay. This is really bad news for you guys because who wants to stay there? Nobody. And then there's the notion of green, you know. What Jan says, when a planner tells you green, half that, because that's going to be too much as well. You get green deserts. When it rains, this poor woman gets stuck in the mud. You know, you need a reason for public space to be there. Heard of Renzo Piano? Him of the Shard? He's going to sue me one day. Like a salmon, I go back to Italy every year for my holidays, and when the kids were young, I used to go down below Naples, this tiny wee place. I got a phone call from a friend, you need to go and see the good volcano. And I went, what's the good volcano? The good volcano was dead, this is probably 12 years ago, Renzo Piano's masterpiece. It's a shopping centre in the shape of the Vesuvius. Vesuvius is over here, right? And you just go, wow. I arrived there probably the end of July, parked somewhere over here. My brains were fried by the time I got in. And inside it was okay, but it was just like, why are you doing this? This is killing all the little municipalities around it because all the young Italians want to go and walk around and do their passeggiata in an air-conditioned place. And you know, then the mayors are wondering why people are not in their city centre. Well, you give that planning permission, hey, it's going to take a while for people to realise that this is nonsense. Even better, Peter Eisenman, when I was a student, this was, I don't have heroes, but this was somebody that I thought really knew what he was talking about. I had the pleasure of having dinner with him, and then he gave a presentation, and he talked about the Città della Cultura, Santiago de Compostela, Galicia, in northern Spain. And it was just like, wow. Apart from he's taking a hilltop, right, off a hill. Santiago's the city of the Camino, the pilgrimages, all these routes. And his drawings are really nice, but I noticed that there was roundabouts and car parks, and I thought, this is a cultural shopping centre. This is no different from the Good Volcano. It has a good label, got lots of European funding, architecturally some interesting things, but after the lecture, I was the first person to ask him a question. I said, could you tell me what the difference between that and a shopping centre is and how it's going to impact negatively the city centre? He spent 45 minutes trying to justify it. He ended up the conversation by saying, I'm going to send you some plane tickets, I'm going to take you and I'm going to show you. I'm still waiting for a plane ticket. Because that is as effed up as anything else. So what we do to cities, you know, I look for pictures of me as a baby, we grow organically till about our 20s. And then, and I've lost a lot of weight recently, we started getting fat. This is what we do to cities. We stop growing them organically, we started to give them steroids, and then the cancerous growths happen. And this is what we do to cities throughout the globe, because it's good for the economy of a place. It isn't, because it's actually going to kill the city. It's the accountancy approach to things. He knew a few things about running a good company. He said, accountants kill good companies, because an accountant wants the same old shit that's bankable. Right? And what we do, and I think what we have to do, is, it's actually not crazy news, but you need to innovate. Understand the current issues to develop the right solutions for the place. Don't look back, understand where you come from, but